Armando Iannucci's Charm Offensive, presented by Armando Iannucci.
Thank you very much. That music, inappropriate to my character, introduces us all to the first in a new series of Armando Iannucci's Charm Offensive, in which, as is suggested by the title, I will be both charming and making remarks about the Pope and the Nazis. All that in a show which, only by my threatening to put MRSA through Broadcasting House's ventilation shafts, did I prevent Radio 4 from calling a midweek romp. And I've got to start by stressing that the political situation at the moment is very fluid. As we record the show, Tony Blair is still Prime Minister for an historic third day. But that could all change by the time this goes out. So to give us the latest state of play on Blair's position, throughout the show we'll be hearing from top political expert Gordon Brown, who'll be on hand to tell how long the Prime Minister will last. Gordon.
6 months.
Thank you, Gordon. Now, of course, as we go on through the night, that figure could come down, couldn't it, Gordon?
18 weeks.
So, as I say, very fluid out there indeed. Now, the Charm Offensive is a sort of a midweek drop-in centre for homeless panellists who haven't got a topical show to go to until Friday. And tonight we've got three of the best of them, so please welcome Phill, Jupitus, John Oliver and Clive Anderson. And I'd like to kick off by us all standing down. Over the past few days, the country has gone standing down crazy. The leaders of the Tory party, the Lib Dems in Scotland, the Ulster Unionists have all stood down. Channel 4's political editor, Eleanor Goodman, has just announced she's standing down. And Andrew Marr has said he's going to stand down but hasn't done so yet, which actually makes him a lame duck chief political editor. So anyone who's been away on holiday for a week will come back seeing Britain as an empty, deserted wasteland, like some strange new edition of Doctor Who, but without Christopher Eccleston's gurning. Who, by the way, is also standing down to spend more time in front of a mirror. So, to begin with tonight, I'd just like to ask everyone on the team whether they're going to stand down and who else they'd like to see stand down, Phil.
I think as a disc jockey, it's taken as a given that I stood down some years ago from just, you know, having a regular career. Because all my kids' mates, parents, you know, they're doctors and lawyers and coppers and things like that. And, oh, what do you do? Well, if you email me, I'll play you a Ruts B-side. I'm basically a jukebox with an appetite.
Do you not consider that a serious position, then?
No, it's not, is it, really? You know, I am just a big old hungry iPod.
Who's eaten 10,000 songs.
Clive, are you still standing?
This is odd, isn't it? You don't stand down, you stand up, or you sit down. But in politics, they stand down. They lie even about their position.
John?
There's all this call for Tony Blair to stand down, but in a sense, he's already gone. He wasn't on the front of the Labour Party manifesto, so thus he's become the first leader in history to despotically airbrush himself out of a photograph since Joseph Stalin airbrushed himself out of his school netball team. He was never in that team.
I think Tony Blair's view was that the electorate should have stood down.
Well, they kind of did. Most of them did. In not turning up to vote. It was the second lowest voter turnout since 1918, when, to be fair, people were a bit busy being dead.
Labour didn't do very well. The Tories really didn't take off. The Lib Dems didn't have a breakthrough. So they all really, by the end, lost.
Yeah. Right. It was an
all
losers
election. End of Reservoir Dogs. But the other interesting thing from the last few days is that Blair's authority has disappeared. His cabinet reshuffle was mostly people saying, I got off. I'm not going.
He brings back people. People resigned from the Labour government. In the old days, John Profumo resigned and he went into charity work for the rest of his life. Hmm. Rather nobly. Now they don't so much resign as they go and sit on the naughty step for a couple of weeks.
I'd love to have actually heard, you know, the correspondent and you know, Andrew Marr going and in there in number 10 they are having the reshuffle and you hear a piano playing and then it suddenly stops.
And Jeff Hoon storms out number 10 looking very, very disappointed. Yeah. But in order to sort of accommodate all his ministers' whims because they refuse to do what he asked them, because he's the cabinet's gimp now, Tony Blair. He's had to come up with all sorts of bizarre sounding new departments and ministries.
Oh, yes.
To Ministry of, was it Productivity and...
It's Productivity, Energy and Industry. It sounds, yes, like a couple of chapters from A Pilgrim's Progress. I mean, you can't really be not busy if you're working there, can you? Oh, it's Productivity, Energy, Industry. Go, do something.
There's an ambassador to Narnia.
Chancellor of the Duchy of Duke Street.
Minister for Tough Love.
Blunkett's in charge of pensions and illegitimate children.
That's quite a bad job for them, isn't it, pensions? Because they're constantly going on about the pensions time bomb. And it turns out that North Korea has actually developed the pensions time bomb. They've got it. And France are testing theirs in the Pacific at the moment. There's an island there that's entirely populated by grannies.
Now, one thing, of course, that was noticed over the election was how dependent Blair became on Brown. We taped one of the Labour rallies that Blair was speaking at over the election, and if you listen very carefully, you can actually hear Gordon Brown in the background prompting Blair what to say.
So here are 10 things a future Labour third term can do for Britain's hard-working families. One,
the economy.
Low mortgage rates, rising living standards, more jobs in every region of the UK... And with the money saved,
pensions.
Design a pension system that has the basic state pension at its core and provides incentives to save
hard-working families.
For hard-working families.
By the way, I ought to point out that throughout the show, to give you, the listener, the fastest, most comprehensive overview of the discussion as it happens, we'll be lacing the programme with two graphics. There's this one to indicate something's happened. And this one to indicate the arrival of a postal vote. How did you take to the graphicization of this general election?
I was part of the graphicization.
Oh,
I was at the ITV party, which we had on a boat by the London Eye. So I was brought in to zhuzh up the election. So I was there. I was chewing the fat with Joan Collins. I was shooting...
Was there a lot of fat to
Shooting the breeze with Tony Benn and arguing the toss with Andrew Neil. So I was there. And it was a very jolly party. But apparently it was... more or less condemned as being rather trivialisation, the whole thing.
Oh, but sorry, I should have said, turning to you, Clive.
I'm sorry, I didn't see the graphics. Were they good this year, then?
They were tip-top. Over to you, John.
They were amazing, yeah. I think it's probably true now that...
Pressure's on you, Phil.
I think pretty much now that the people that make the graphics must just be doing it for a bet. Now, they must just be in the pub the previous night going, I bet you £20 that I can get Peter Snow to present anything. I'll take that bet. Do you reckon you could get him to commentate in front of an animation of the three main party leaders strutting down Downing Street like self-confident Barry Gibbs? Do you reckon you could do that? And he would look back and say, I don't even view that as a challenge.
So one thing on election, I couldn't work out whether Robert Kilroy Silk was a graphic. So did you want me to hand over to you, Phil?
Yes. Armando. You see me, I have to go to bed early, and so I miss the actual coverage during the night. So I got up at 4 a.m. when every television presenter had lost the will to live. And it was like the end of Lord of the Flies. Paxman stripped to the waist with blood on his chest, wearing his tie as a headband, proclaiming himself God, eating the head of John Pienaar.
My God, that's a big head, isn't it?
Blast him into the long winter.
Let's move on. But before we leave the election, I'd just like to point out there's no points awarded to guests on this show, but we will be measuring how they're doing using a new computer graphic called Starfish. Now, Starfish is so-called because it stands for State-of-the-Art Final Information Studio Holographer, and also because it's an actual starfish.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.